with his back, and as usual with drama and a jaw-dropping surprise. His recent battle with cancer seems to have been won, and there's a new marriage and a hidden daughter we never knew he had. His life has been an epic story, every soaring achievement tempered by disharmony and conflict. From humble beginnings in a Yorkshire mining village, a fanatical dedication to his cricket turned him into the leading run scorer in history. His single-minded pursuit of greatness polarised opinion. People either loved or loathed him. And when his playing days were over, he embarked on a second successful career as a commentator and columnist. But then, at the peak of his fame and wealth, triumph turned to disaster. He was accused by his own girlfriend of a frenzied assault during a holiday in the south of France. In the revelations that followed, the achievements of a lifetime came crashing down around him. Geoffrey Boycott's trial in France was at first glance about a lover's tiff that went horribly wrong.
I would like to see Geoffrey sorry for what he's done. I'd like him to receive treatment and I'd like to make sure he never does it again.
I've never hit her. Until the day I die, I'm always going to say that because I believe it.
As Boycott battled to save his reputation in a French court, his life was laid open to scrutiny. One surprising fact emerged. This apparently charmless man was revealed to have exerted a powerful attraction over a string of women. At his trial, he was surrounded by a gaggle of loyal former girlfriends.
He's always been an attractive man. He's very attentive to women. And you tend to want to mother him, I think, in a lot of ways.
I mean, why would you go to bed with Geoffrey Boycott? He'd be at you all night saying, no, that's bad technique, is that? No, look, you've got your legs in the wrong position. You're not moving, you're not leaning. What's the matter with thee?
So, how did these characteristics go to make up cricket's most celebrated and most loathed batsman? The innings which cemented Geoffrey Boycott's place amongst cricket's greats was its 100th first-class 100. It was scored where else? At his beloved Headingley, where he still manages to polarise opinion amongst the cricketing folk of Yorkshire.
I like him, I always have done, and I always will do.
I thought Geoff Boycott played for himself and not for Yorkshire.
He was good for Yorkshire, he was good for England, and some would say he was good for himself.
He's the best self-made player there's ever been in the history of the game.
Arrogant, rude, yes.
Geoffrey is one of those sort of people who wants people to like him, but thinks that a lot of people don't, and he's probably right.
There's a sort of kind of cliche about, you know, Yorkshire flinty people, and I've done cabarets there, and people always say, what's the comic like? And people saying, well, he's all right if you like laughing.
When Geoffrey Boycott strode onto the field at Trent Bridge for his first England cap in 1964, he seemed to conform to every cliché of the tough cricketer from a mining background who would join the production line of professional Yorkshiremen.
Myself, Michael Parkinson and Geoffrey Boycott, we all came from the same background. My father worked down a coal mine from being 13 years of age to 65.
But although Geoffrey shared the same mining roots as his cricketing predecessors, from an early age he was startlingly different.
Geoffrey's father, he worked down the pit as well, but he had to come out of the mines, Geoffrey's father, because of ill health.
Geoffrey was just 9 when his father was crushed by a wagon underground at the pit, suffering injuries from which he never fully recovered. His father's condition drove Geoffrey close to his mother, Jane. It was she, not his father, who taught him how to play cricket and triggered his lifelong obsession with the game.
Mrs. Boycott, can you remember when Geoff first started playing cricket?
Can I remember?
Yes, when you were about 8 or 9 years old.
Whereabouts did you play?
Out in the backyard. Dustbin for the wickets. Me and my sister bawling at him.
The whole family became tied up in his success. Jane's brother Algie helped pay for cricket coaching and to buy Geoffrey a cricket bat.
It was unusual for anyone to have a bat, but it cost a lot of money and the wages were very low. We used to arrive at school at 8:30 in the morning and we'd play 25 minutes of cricket before we went into school. He was really keen, dead keen on playing all the time.
Geoffrey never let the bat leave his hands. He was a self-absorbed little boy.
He spoke to people, but he didn't mix with people. He only knew about 6 in the village. He was a loner.
The solitary Geoffrey set about gaining experience in the tough world of local league cricket.
He used to go to Wackworth Cricket Club on a Tuesday and Thursday, and Geoffrey had to be down there at 5:30 to put the nets up, and then at 9:00 he had to take them down again when they finished. And if he was lucky, someone may stay and have a ball at him.
After serving his time at Ackworth, Geoffrey graduated to Yorkshire League Club Barnsley.
When I saw him at that age, a young age of 15 and 16, I thought he would play county cricket. But I didn't think he would go any further than that, I'm being honest with you. What impressed me mostly was his tremendous mental strength, this belief that he had in himself. We were sat on the boundary edge, Michael Parkinson, myself and Geoff Boycott. And I remember him saying to us that his one ambition was to play for Yorkshire, of course, and to play for England.
There was a long way to go before the single-minded young man could fulfil that ambition, and he would depend for a long time on his mother's support.
Geoffrey Boycott's mother was a huge influence in his life, and they had a very intense relationship. And he often said, referring to his achievements in cricket, "I owe it all to Mum."
He worshipped his mother, he thought the world of her. She did everything for him, and she was just a wonderful woman to him.
Because his mother showered him with so much affection, he had this tremendous sense of drive and ambition. He also often felt suffocated, and that's why Boycott never wanted marriage and settling down. Marriage was always something Boycott dreaded throughout his life. He often said he'd rather drop dead than be married.
Amazingly, Geoffrey carried on living at home with his mother till he was nearly 40. And there was never any chance of his mother letting him follow his father down the pit. With professional cricket still a distant dream, after leaving school at 18, Geoffrey found a white-collar job at the Ministry of Pensions in Barnsley. The job brought him a salary, status, and sex. For it was here that he started a love affair with a married woman 14 years older than him. It was just the first in a series of affairs which would continue throughout his life.
Lost at love before, but you said try just once more. I chose you for the one, now I'm having so much fun. You treated me so kind, I'm about to lose my mind. You made me so very happy.
With American Express, one phone call to the Platinum Charge Card Concierge Service can arrange to show how much you care, even when you're miles from home.
Get your free CD this Saturday in The Guardian in association with Oxfam, featuring Coldplay, REM, Chemical Brothers and Radiohead.
Smile. heart is aching. Smile, even though it's breaking. When there are clouds in the sky, you'll get by if you smile through your fear and sorrow. Smile and maybe tomorrow you'll find that life is still worthwhile if you just smile.
大家飲杯，飲杯，飲杯，飲杯，飲杯。大家食噶。
The English believe it's a slur on your host's food if you don't clear your plate.
Okay.
Whereas the Chinese feel you're questioning their generosity if you do.
马兄弟，好，马兄弟。
At HSBC, we never underestimate the importance of local knowledge, which is why we have local banks staffed by local people in more countries than anyone else.
Okay.
HSBC, the world's local bank.
Introducing the PowerMac G5, the world's fastest, most powerful personal computer.
The new woman in Geoffrey Boycott's life was Anne Wyatt, a fellow clerical officer at the Ministry of Pensions.
Anne Wyatt was the first serious relationship Boycott had in his life. I think it was just the classic attraction of the younger man to the more sophisticated older woman.
She was a rock at the side of Geoffrey and she kept him going. She was wonderful to him, I'll tell you that now. She played a tremendous part, I think, in the success of Geoffrey Boycott and Wyatt.
Anne left her husband for Geoffrey. But though their relationship lasted for nearly 30 years, Geoffrey wouldn't leave home for her. Being looked after by his mother suited him too well. And in a pattern he would repeat for most of his life, he resisted any idea of marrying Anne. But he was also drawn to the attractions of London. It could have been a million miles from the mining village of Fitzwilliam. Step forward singer and sometime carry-on actress, Shirley Weston.
When we went to the Empire Leicester Square with the band, he turned up one night. I think he was quite taken up with the glamour of it all and came backstage and we just clicked from the first time we met. His comment was, well, we haven't seen anything like that in Fitzwilliam. Whenever he came to London, he kept coming to see me, and it just, over the years, it became quite a nice romance. He used to call me the pocket battleship.
Determined to keep the affair a secret, Boycott insisted on her complete discretion.
He thought that having, especially someone like myself, who was in the show business, might have been a black mark against him. So we decided to keep it quite quiet. And it was many years before anyone really discovered that we'd been going out or anything.
All this time, he was trying to break into the Yorkshire county side. But he was no boy wonder and made no impact on the game whatsoever. It was five long years before Yorkshire finally took him on as a professional, and he could give up his civil service job.
I'm taking the opportunity to speak to Jeff Boycott before the start of the vital Yorkshire-Sussex match. Now, Jeff, you've had a tremendous amount of publicity.
He came across as a very reserved young man.
But last year, I felt somewhat strange with players that I'd only met with at the beginning of the season when we were practicing, but who I hadn't played with. And after playing 3, 4, 5 games last year, and then starting to play with them again this year, I felt at ease, I felt at home, I felt I was part of the side, and so my confidence grew, and I was able to go out and play cricket.
The Yorkshire side he joined were cricket's Manchester United, a bear pit of arrogant, self-confident personalities. Among them was legendary England fast bowler, fiery Fred Truman, whose rivalry with Boycott would last 30 years.
I don't know when I first saw him. If he was in the nets as a kid, you know, so insignificant in those days that I wouldn't have noticed him anyway. I always thought to myself he was a bit insecure. I brought him home from the car and I went to Fitzwilliam and I was astounded when he said, oh, drop me here. So I said, oh, do you live here? He said, no. And I said, well, I'll take you to our house. No, 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 I'll be all right here, he said. And he got his bags and things out of my car and walked the rest of the way. It seemed as though he didn't want anybody to go near the house.
Boycott's sense of inadequacy was hardly helped by the verdict of club captain Brian Close.
At that time, we had 2 or 3 good young cricketers coming on. He was the least natural talented of them.
But Boycott had a driving will to overcome his shortcomings. With no interests outside the game, he honed his technique at every opportunity.
He'd play for Yorkshire every match. He'd play every day. He'd play anywhere. He'd come back and play in the Yorkshire League where he started.
Boycott created a safety-first defensive style which completely eliminated risk. It meant that he scored painfully slowly. His approach to the game polarised opinion. Some admired his Yorkshire grit.
He would bat from start of play to lunchtime, then he'd bat after lunch to tea time, and then he'd bat from after tea to close of play.
Others thought that his method showed that he simply wasn't a team player.
I think Geoffrey chose the wrong game. It was so self-centred, he'd have made a top-class, absolute, died-in-the-wood golfer.
He became a machine for accumulating runs. While his slow play could be vitally important to anchor an innings, he refused to vary his game when the situation demanded it, such as one-day cricket, where runs had to be scored as quickly as possible. Things came to a head in the Gillette Cup final of 1965. Boycott's maddening refusal to attack the bowling so infuriated Captain Brian Close that he gave him an ultimatum.
I went out there and I told him, listen, next bloody ball, I says, bloody well belt it, otherwise I'll wrap this bat round your bloody head. Next ball came up, crash, straight through extra cover for 4.
He portrayed strokes that I didn't think he could play. We went on to win the cup and he won man of the match.
Press and public acclaimed the innings. It seemed to herald a turning point in Boycott's career, but he judged that the risks weren't worth it, and it was the only time that he really let rip.
That showed what shots he could play, and it was a shame that he never allowed himself to play more often like that.
To everyone's exasperation, Boycott perversely went back into his shell. The defining Boycott innings came in a test match against India in 1967. He made a huge score of 246, which helped give England victory, but it took him 2 whole days to do it.
The selectors actually dropped him. But I didn't. I spoke up for him. But I was outvoted, so he was left out of the next test match.
Boycott was absolutely livid at this slight. His sense of injustice would never leave him. He regained his test place, but became, if anything, even more bloody-minded.
Beautiful on drive. Gleeson to Boycott, a beautiful shot. Four runs.
His legendary egomania was demonstrated against Australia in 1971.
He was batting with Basil D'Oliveira against the Aussie mystery spinner of the time, John Gleeson, who bowled back of the hand but with a mysterious action.
None of the England batsmen had been able to work out how to play Gleeson.
Basil D'Oliveira suddenly reeled off three or four fours in succession off Gleeson and came up beaming at the end of the over to Boycott, his partner, and said, it's easy, isn't it, when you know how? And Jeff Boycott said, I know, but don't tell the others.
Boycott's refusal to compromise his personal ambition for the sake of the team was plain for all to see when he took over the Yorkshire captaincy in 1971.
As captain, you know, he was more concerned with how he did than with how the team did. And frankly, if he was piling up the runs, however slowly, however patiently, he couldn't give a bugger about anybody else.
Playing for the county side with Boycott became a torment for his teammates.
Particularly with test matches coming up, he tended to use those games for Geoffrey getting as much batting practice as he could to make sure he was in the best form for playing for England. And it didn't matter what happened to the rest of the lads playing for him. Geoffrey could make the runs a lot more quickly. I think the thing that annoyed us most of all was that he would play five balls of an over and get one off the last ball.
It all meant that Boycott was an isolated figure at the club. Often his only ally in the world seemed to be Anne Wyatt, who was a frequent visitor to the ground.
Geoffrey was very sensitive about Anne. When we were playing at Headingley, there was a knock on the door and Jeff Cope went down, and Copey came up back upstairs into the dressing room, walked over to Geoffrey and said, oh, Geoffrey, your mother's waiting for you downstairs. So Geoffrey quickly went downstairs and came back, and he gave Jeff Cope the biggest rocket of all time. Let me remind you, that is not my mother, that is my lady friend.
Boycott's poor leadership of Yorkshire was an insuperable obstacle when the England captaincy, his great dream, came up in 1973.
It was my last test match as captain against the West Indies, and I found out that Mike Dinesh was going to take over, and I rang Jeff at the night and I said, I'm sorry, old lad, but you haven't got it.
By far the most senior England player, Boycott was denied the captaincy which he thought was his by right. Mortified by this insult, in 1974 Boycott took the extraordinary decision that he wouldn't play for England at all.
He didn't think Mike Dinesh should have been captain. He didn't get it, and he took his bat home, if you want, over that.
Boycott was at the peak of his powers, and after all the years of graft he put in since his youthful boast to Dickie Bird, his fit of pique astounded his peers.
The greatest thing that can be bestowed upon you is to play for your country. Three lions and a crown.
He deprived himself of the thing he held most dear. But as always with Boycott, more high drama was just around the corner. In 1977, after 3 years of test exile, Geoffrey Boycott announced that he was available to play for England again. Because of the huge number of runs he'd scored for Yorkshire in the meantime, the selectors had to take him back. His first test match was against the old enemy, Australia, at Trent Bridge. Batting with Boycott was the local Nottinghamshire hero, Derek Randall.
You got all your family and relations all wanting you to do particularly well, so I was feeling pretty good, really, and I got on well with the supporters at Nottingham, so they wanted me to do well. He must have been pretty nervous himself, and he got away to a reasonable start, 20 or 30. It took him an hour and a half.
Then the runs dried up completely for Boycott. he became increasingly desperate to get his score moving again.
Jeff Thompson was bowling from my end, and Jeff hit the ball straight back down the wicket.
They did play the ball straight back just to Jeff Thompson's right hand.
And he charged down the pitch and called Randall for a run. It's almost saying to Randall, stand your ground, don't move out of your ground, run him out, it's his fault, stay where you are. But Randall just walked out of his ground. And they were so livid that Boycott had run Randall out. Marsh just smashed all the three stumps out of the ground, run out. Randall just carried on into the pavilion. Very sad.
I remember getting off the field as quickly as possible because, you know, you could see the Australians were exuberant.
Not a shadow of doubt, it was Jeff's fault.
Running between the wickets is the part of cricket that demands cooperation between batsmen. And throughout his career, Boycott was notorious for running out his partners.
He'd judge a run on whether he could get to the other end, not whether the other batsman could get to his end.
Having antagonised the crowd and wound up the Australians, the only possible way to redeem himself was a big score. And showing remarkable courage and concentration, Boycott duly went on to make a century and help win the game. It was a triumphant return to the England side. It meant that in the next Test match, Boycott had the chance of a lifetime.
It was Australia at Headingley, on your own home ground. Greg Chappell bowling to him, I can see it now. Half volleyed past mid-on.
It was Geoffrey Boycott's 100th first-class 100, the only player ever to achieve the feat in a Test match.
I'll never forget that ball sat on the balcony when he straight drove to the boundary, and that was just a marvellous thing for Geoffrey Boycott, and it put us in a good position in the Test match as well.
You can remember him sitting there, both arms outstretched, and I think that was a very, very exciting moment for Geoffrey.
It was the most glorious moment in the career of the minor son from Fitzwilliam. It established him as the preeminent batsman of his era. He got there by extraordinary perseverance, self-discipline, and relentless practice.
I remember once him going to a cow patch of a ground in Antigua to practice on a concrete strip, and there's all weeds and the grass is about a foot high. He's got an old tyre, I think, as a wicket, and he's got a couple of local lads bowling at him.
But now an even more important milestone was in his sights. Gary Sober's record of all-time highest Test match run scorer.
Sober's was his ego. He even pulled his shirt collar up to be dressed like Gary Sober's.
As time went on, he became more particular in his habits. He preferred his own hotel room on tour and could be prickly if he had to share.
Normally we leave the key in the door for whoever you're sharing with. Of course, there was no key in the door, there was no spare key, so I had to knock on the door. It was just after 11, so it wasn't late to be met by Geoffrey saying, what time do you call this? So the usual thing was to look at the watch and say, well, it's 10 past 11. Don't let this happen again. You know, I need my sleep.
Insights into his mysterious private life were rare. He turned out to be a surprising ladies' man.
He was embarrassed if we happened to walk into a restaurant and he was there with somebody, or you happened to be going into the car park as they were getting into or out of a car.
The solitary Boycott was at last made captain of England when Mike Brearley was injured in 1978. The big question was, would he be able to actually lead the team?
Another one, that's the fourth time out.
Crisis came in a Test match in New Zealand. England needed to score quickly, and Boycott was as usual plodding along.
We needed to score quick runs to get a declaration in, really, and to try and get a bowl at New Zealand that evening. Now, Boyks was in his inevitable self. You know, Richard Hadley was bowling, and there's no way he was going. Richard's going to give Richard Hadley his wicket.
Chatfield to Randall.
He's given him that. I was run out backing up by Hugh and Chatfield, which was probably the worst thing that happened in my cricket career.
Next in was a man who was more than a match for Boycott, Ian Botham. Although playing in only his fourth Test match, he showed no respect for his captain whatsoever.
As I was walking off, Botham said to me, "said don't worry, I'll run Boycott out on. We'll get on with the bloody game."
Ian Botham was sent out to bat with the sole purpose of running out Geoffrey Boycott.
This Chatfield bowls to a high, wide and handsome field.
So he nudged the ball off for a single and called Geoffrey Boycott for this impossible run.
Botham gets it, looking for a single, could be out, there's sure to be a run out here.
Boycott was run out and had to walk past Botham on his way back to the pavilion. And Botham still says to this day that Boycott walked past him saying, "What have you done? What have you done? You've run me out. What about me average?"
Only afterwards did Boycott learn that the entire team had conspired to get him out. He lasted just four games as England captain. It wasn't just England who'd lost confidence in him as captain. He may have been Yorkshire's top scorer for 15 seasons, but his presence in the team destroyed morale. He was sacked as captain.
It is nothing to do with what Mr. Boycott has done or has not done. It is to do with what he is. Captaincy is above all a matter of leadership. This is the quality which, in the honest and sincere opinion of a majority of the committee, is the quality which Mr. Boycott lacks.
Boycott viewed the hostility he met as purely the result of jealousy amongst the old guard.
Boycott says that Fred Truman was the biggest character in Yorkshire cricket until he came along and he knocked Truman off his pedestal, and that's why Truman hates him. Boycott puts that down to jealousy.
Jealous of him?
The loss of the captaincy was a particularly bitter blow, coming just days after the death of his mother in September 1978. Away from the turmoil of Yorkshire, Boycott now focused obsessively on Gary Sober's international run record. And on the 23rd of December 1981 in Delhi, the tortoise finally overtook the hare. Boycott passed Sober's record and became the world's leading run scorer. But the applause had hardly died down when he walked into a new controversy. He helped organise a rebel tour of apartheid South Africa. For over a decade, South Africa had been excluded from international cricket. The tour caused an uproar that extended well beyond cricketing circles.
There was a lot of trouble back home because it was a groundbreaking trip. You know, we were a party of privately organised cricketers going to play cricket against a South African 11, but it didn't go down too well at home. He did grow a beard. If it was a disguise, it didn't work very well because, you know, everyone recognised him.
Back home again, and without the disguise, the flinty Yorkshireman was, as usual, completely impervious to the upset he caused.
We gathered that there had been death threats against you, which is why the police were out in force this morning. Is there anything in that? No?
Excuse me, I've got to get a taxi.
Boycott and his fellow rebels were all banned from playing for England. And when he returned to Yorkshire, he found that many regarded his South Africa adventure as one controversy too far. In the dressing room that Boycott dominated for so long, he was now seen as a liability. With his best years behind him, the knives were out.
There seemed to be mutterings in one corner, there was mutterings in another corner. It seemed to have a very divided dressing room.
The players were asked if they wanted their former captain in the team at all.
12 said no, they didn't want Geoffrey to play, and one refused to answer the question.
The result of the poll provided ammunition to the committee. They finally bit the bullet and made the dramatic decision to release Boycott as a player.
they were talking about sacking him, and I said, well, if you're talking about it, why don't you do it?
But if the committee thought their troubles were over, they were wrong. Boycott supporters were outraged.
It was totally unjust to sack him.
Ladies and gentlemen, fellow members, the stench of dirty laundry came wafting out of Headingley once
disgusted by the sacking, they hurriedly arranged local meetings to rally support for reinstating Boycott. Like that.
I organised one in Murfield. It was held in some fairly small premises and the place was absolutely packed out. We could have had, really, we needed a much bigger room.
Boycott's future convulsed not just the club, but the whole county. There was virtually a civil war as the people of Yorkshire divided over his fate. Boycott memorial gates were erected at Ackworth, and at Queen Elizabeth's School in Wakefield, they even performed a musical about him.
Geoffrey Boycott, should he go? Geoffrey Boycott, should he stay? That's the question on the lips of every Yorkshireman today. Geoffrey Boycott,
with tensions running high, the pro-Boycott lobby called for a showdown at a special meeting of the membership of the Yorkshire Cricket Club.
Geoffrey Boycott, should he go? Geoffrey Boycott, should he stay? Should we make him hang his boots up or invite him back to play?
Through sheer numbers, his supporters overturned the decision to oust him by voting in a new leadership.
We still think he's in, and we still think he's out!
Among the heads that rolled was long-time foe Fred Truman.
Fred was probably the biggest shock of all, because he was so famous and well-known.
I'm sad, I'm bitter about the whole sordid performance that is taking place. This club played its first county match against Norfolk at Sheffield in 1833. That's 151 years ago. We've never had any trouble until this man came.
The coup de grace for Boycott supporters was to vote Boycott himself onto the new committee.
How's that?
He was now in the unique position of playing for and effectively running the club.
County club shouldn't be run by a player. In those committee meetings when he controlled the Yorkshire County Cricket Club in the middle 80s, he controlled 17 votes out of 23.
You could sense the friction and the atmosphere and the tenseness which existed for a long time afterwards.
I never spoke to him for about 7 or 8 years. I never spoke to him at all.
I did say, Jeff, you've split the team a little bit, you've split the committee, you've split the membership. And if you truly love Yorkshire, you would leave Yorkshire now.
True to form, Boycott never did quit. After 2 years of bitter acrimony, the anti-Boycott camp regrouped and overthrew the new committee. It was the end for Boycott both as a committee member and as a player. Boycott has scored over 48,000 first-class runs and 151 centuries. He wasn't finished yet. A whole new career as a cricket commentator awaited him. Yet the very characteristics that enabled him to achieve so much, his single-mindedness and indifference to what others thought of him, were finally going to provide the seeds of his downfall. His playing career over, Geoffrey Boycott swapped his bat for a microphone. For someone who found communication difficult on a personal level, commentating provided the public stage that he had so enjoyed as a batsman.
It's quality, not quantity, that counts. He wants to get his front foot forward, block it out a bit more. Now, if I'd been out there this afternoon...
Whenever I've been around test matches and he's in the commentary box, and, I mean, he'll usually sort of appear at the end of the corridor and say, no, you're going to do me, you can't do me, you get the wrong riding, you can't do me, you can't do me, which I translate as, do me, go on, do me.
I'd have taken twice as long to score about 15 quality runs and then run myself out.
I think he's a great commentator. He's terrific. He doesn't hold back on his opinions.
He's got extremely strong views. He certainly will never have a sore bottom from sitting on the fence.
He was very imaginative in his use of language and some of the terms like the corridor of uncertainty. Just a fantastic... It sounds like an Edgar Allan Poe novel. And it was actually about someone bowling outside your off stump.
Boycott was at the height of his fame and fortune. He was a brilliant, blunt-spoken and highly paid commentator and columnist. Boycott was also keeping up his past record as a dedicated ladies' man. Throughout his life, he kept a string of lovers, but now relieved of the rigours of playing cricket, he moved into overdrive. Although he was now living with Anne Wyatt, his lover of 20 years, this was by no means an exclusive relationship. His string of affairs included Rachel Swinglehurst, who he'd been secretly dating since 1974. And although it wasn't publicised at the time, she fell pregnant in 1988. Boycott was shell-shocked by the news that he was to be a father. Whilst the couple kept in contact after the birth, it was some years before he built up a relationship with his daughter Emma. Then in 1992, he started seeing Margaret Moore. She appeared to be a successful and wealthy businesswoman who was also keen to help him with his PR.
I effectively acted as his agent, but without any payment, because I was in love with him.
In October 1996, they flew to the south of France to stay at the exclusive Hotel de Cap in Antibes. The working-class Yorkshire lad had come a long way. But just when everything looked rosy, things started to go wrong. They both agree that on the third day of their holiday, they had lunch together. They agree that an argument developed. But here the two versions of what happened next sharply diverge.
He told me off for not making enough money for him.
It's all about, and always has been, about me marrying her.
He stormed off to their room and began to pack his suitcase.
She came up, absolutely furious.
What are you doing?
And I picked up his toilet bag and I threw it out of the window.
She came out, angry as hell, started taking my shoes and clothes out of my suitcase, throwing them out of the window.
And I threw a couple of other things out of the window too.
I went to restrain her. She started hitting and kicking me.
He grabbed me like that, really, really badly, pushed me to the ground.
In the grappling, I slipped. On this side, I hit my left elbow. She caught the right side of her head.
He had his legs over my legs, so I couldn't move, and he was punching me with his other hand.
I never assaulted her at all. I grappled, we slipped, to stop her and restrain her from going absolutely crazy she was.
I called a doctor.
That night, she was sat up with me, drinking champagne, with Billy Joel, the famous American singer.
After this surprising encounter, they spent another couple of nights together before travelling back to London. Boycott thought the whole business in France was over. But Margaret Moore, deprived of the chance of marrying Boycott, still planned to make money by selling her story.
She approached me, asked me to represent her, to sell the story, and I said no.
She went straight away to the News of the World and got paid a large sum of money. These are facts. Go and check it.
The tabloids followed up with a blitz of stories about Boycott's affairs, as well as Anne Wyatt, Shirley Weston, Rachel Swinglehurst, and Margaret Moore. Two more lovers emerged from Boycott's hitherto very private personal life. It completely overturned the public perception of Boycott. The story that unfolded was not just of his passion for women, but his reluctance to commit fully to any of them. Meanwhile, the spurned Margaret Moore mounted a prosecution of Boycott for assault in a French court in Grasse. A stag at bay, Boycott prepared to defend himself. The stakes could hardly have been higher, for if found guilty, no media organisation would employ him. However, he found it hard to get people to speak out in his favour.
One of the great ironies was when the court case was pending, he was going around a lot of the people that he played with over the years, asking them to sign an affidavit saying that he wasn't a violent man. And he was somebody who, throughout his career, had built up this thing of never caring what people thought about him. And here he was, desperate, really, to have people attest to his character.
In another irony, Boycott then himself approached Max Clifford for help in getting his message across.
Geoffrey, when he first came to see me, was both angry and upset. For a Yorkshireman to pay me the vast sums of money that I charge, he must have been upset. It was a challenge. He's not Mr. Charm.
Without the backing of the great and the good, Boycott assembled his closest advisors and former girlfriends as character witnesses. He seemed to have accumulated mistresses just like he had done runs.
You had this irresistible image of Henry VIII turning up with divorced, beheaded, died, divorced, beheaded, and that one I'm not sure about.
The trial was like nothing I'd ever experienced in my life. There were two or three ladies. There was one who was a bit older, I seem to remember, who was dressed up to the nines in a bright red miniskirt. And every time the camera was there, she'd run in these little high heels like an Olympic sprinter to get in front of the camera.
I said I would stand up in any court and swear on my life that I couldn't imagine him ever lifting a hand to anybody.
It all seemed to be going Boycott's way. He even managed to get Moore's former lawyer to speak out against her.
She had previously told me, in my capacity as a friend, that she had fallen.
But his initial confidence was quickly dented when he discovered that everyone was speaking in a foreign language.
You've got both counsel speaking in French, the president speaking in French, the prosecutor speaking in French. You're four people speaking about you, and you don't know what the hell they're saying.
And the judge appointed to the case was utterly unimpressed with Boycott's status.
I'm French, and I know nothing about cricket. And I never heard of Geoffrey Boycott.
The judge was a woman. And she seemed to... I mean, you expect it with people like us in show business, short skirts and cleavage. But you don't expect it of a judge.
Geoffrey's arrogant, and Geoffrey is a male chauvinist, and that's how he comes across. I don't think she was too taken with him. And of course, Margaret Moore is a pretty good actress. She's looking all demure and innocent, and she was quite convincing.
Madame Moore, she seems to me perfectly calm, normal.
Boycott's defence was essentially that it was completely out of character for him to have hit a woman. But Boycott's team felt the judge was against them.
The judge, she was asking, how did your relationship break up? Did it break up because he used to hit you, because he was violent?
And unfortunately for Boycott, in the judge's eyes, his character witnesses counted for nothing compared to the evidence of the doctor who had examined Margaret Moore.
I declare Mr. Boycott guilty.
She gave Boycott a 3-month suspended sentence and a 50,000 franc fine. The now long abandoned courtroom had witnessed the ruin of Boycott's elaborate preparations. The full consequences of the verdict were now clear. As well as the sentence and fine, he had a massive legal bill to pay. Worst of all, his reputation was in tatters. The Sun, which had used him for years as a correspondent, turned on him with a vengeance.
But Geoffrey was devastated. I mean, you know, he'd lost his job on the Sun. He was angry, he was upset, he was waxing lyrical about the injustice.
Boycott appealed against the verdict, but failed to establish any doubt in the higher court's mind.
I can't understand how there can't be any doubt. I've done my best. That's what I've always done. I've never run away from anything. That's the reason I came here with an appeal. I've always fronted up, and that's what I've done today. And
for him to fall, it was all the people who he'd used in the past in his single-minded, selfish pursuit of fame and fortune embodied in that one woman. It was going to happen at some point. And in a sense, it happened when he was least expecting it. I think, you know, to use a cricket term, he'd probably taken his eye off the ball at that point.
Throughout all his troubles, his long-term girlfriend, Rachel Swinglehurst, the mother of his 14-year-old daughter Emma, remained loyal. Although she was left to bring up Emma alone for so many years, Rachel stood by him when he faced a new battle in September 2002. After finding a lump in his throat, doctors diagnosed that Boycott had cancer.
Yorkshire cricketing legend Geoffrey Boycott has cancer.
Yes, the former England and Yorkshire captain confirmed today that tests had confirmed cancerous tissue in his throat.
While receiving treatment, Geoff and Rachel's relationship grew stronger. Now ready to take on the family he'd kept secret for so many years, he proved his commitment when in March 2003, despite vowing never to marry, the cricketer secretly tied the knot with Rachel in a low-key ceremony in Yorkshire. Just 2 months ago, the hardy Yorkshireman announced that he was winning the toughest test of his life.
I'm a lot better, I'm in remission. That means, like every cancer patient, you're not cured, you just go for your checkups every month and you cross your fingers and hope that so-and-so don't come back.
To this day, Boycott is either loved or loathed, both publicly and personally, by all who know him. The very qualities that made him such a difficult and controversial cricketer, his single-minded determination, dogged perseverance, and inability to compromise, are the very qualities that made him one of the greatest sportsmen Britain has ever produced.
I don't think Geoffrey Boycott is ever really going to change in terms of his personality and outlook. I think Geoffrey is always going to be someone who says it as he sees it. But to me, the pluses outweigh the minuses.
Even Boycott's worst enemies can't deny him his place in the record books as one of the all-time greats of the game.
He's the greatest self-made player, batsman, I should say, probably ever.
I think you'd always have had to find a place in an all-time 11 for Boycott in the first six batsmen, one of six players. His record speaks for itself on that.
If I had to pick one batsman to bat for my life, it would be Geoffrey Boycott to bat for my life.
Was this the story of the real Geoff Boycott or just more tabloid TV? Tell us what you think about this or any other programme on any TV channel by logging on to channel4.com/thinktv. Next week at 10, The Salon is back in business on 4. Reality TV is steps into porn set next. Seymour Butts plies his trade at the most exclusive awards ceremony, second to the Oscars.